As Abraham Coon and his family approached their new home September 17, 1850, after arduous weeks of travel, they looked out across the Great Salt Lake Valley at a beautiful range of mountains, a mountain range that would soon play an important part in their lives. At the north end of these ochres, they also viewed the Great Salt Lake and heard the cry of the seagulls in the distance. Today, we still hear the cry of the gulls returning to their nests upon the islands, a plaintive call that ties us to the past as we share a few moments of our ancestors' lives. With Abraham Coon, we ask, who am I? Where are my roots? What is my heritage? Listen closely while the Abraham Coon historians and genealogists unfold the story. Abraham Coon's wives have roots in the ancient British tribes. Their earliest ancestry entered the country before the dawn of recorded history. These were the Britons who worshipped here at Stonehenge and in their sacred groves. Other ancestors who challenged the supremacy of the Britons were the Romans. This group built rock walls to provide protection against Britons, Picts, and Scots. This wall, built in 120 AD by the Emperor Hadrian, is 74 miles long. Following the removal of the Romans, the Saxons rushed in with fury upon the now civilized Britons. The British fell back into Wales, building walls and homes from scattered stones of surrounding countrysides. Researchers Evelyn Goble, Murial, Griffith, and Faye Husberg stand before such a wall as they travel about searching out the history of the family. After driving the Welsh out, the Saxons set up ruling families and lived in the countryside of central England. They were driven back themselves by invading Danes. Our ancestor, King Harold, a Saxon, became a Danish ruler. He and his sons owned 20 manors across this Kentish countryside. Here, upon the battlefield of Hastings, William the Conqueror slew King Harold. We descend from both. Widow of Harold, Edith Swanashell, fled to the Isle of Sheppey with her children. They were political prisoners of Duke William. The Yarborough and Wilson names are of Danish descent, families that supported William the Conqueror. The Yarborough Parish Church serves the countryside of Yarborough, Lincolnshire. It is named for the Yarborough family. One Wilson branch dates back to Yorkshire and Robert Wilson in 1277, who owned Brinkcliffe Tower. The parish of Yarborough is one of the oldest parishes in Lincolnshire. Note the sign, its name for the family. Throughout the centuries, the family grew. The bloods of all these people mingled and spread through England. In Kent, this parish church, set among the yew trees, held a deep significance to our ancestors. Among the most notable of our families were John of Gaunt and his third wife, Catherine de Roe Swinford. She is buried here in the Lincoln Cathedral. Early descendants of Harold and Edith lie behind the walls of this church, Minster Abbey on the Isle of Sheppey. They were buried in 1325 and 1330. They are the remains of John de Northwold and his wife, Lady Joan. William and Henry Norwood's tombs are found at Leckhampton Parish Church. William died September 23rd, 1632, and he's the grandfather of our ancestor, William Norwood, who immigrated to Virginia. Some of the finest examples of brasses in England include George Throckmorton and his wife, Anna Catherine Vox. They had 8 sons and 11 daughters in their home of Coon Court. Coon Court today is an excellent example of British architecture. It is one of the outstanding homes in England. During the British Civil War, it was bombarded by Oliver Cromwell and his Puritan forces. Throughout the countryside are other ancestral mansions. One of these is the Leagon Arms. Shown in front of the old home are the family researchers, descendants of the Leagons. British claims to the New World were made in 1491 by John Cabot. This was 1 year before Columbus. In 1578, cousin Walter Raleigh began planting the first British colonies. Members of our family were among those who first entered the New World from ports such as this. In Virginia, among the first 105 men to land at Jamestown in 1607, we count seven family names. This is an unusually high number for any family. During the next 11 years, two-thirds of these colonists died from malnutrition and disease. Among the earliest settlers were our Jordan family. Here we see the thickness of the foliage, which had to be removed from the original plantations. This picture was taken by the researchers on the actual location of the early Jordan plantation in Virginia. William Norwood, who married Lydia Jordan, carved his plantation from this wet wilderness. As we can see, much effort was made by our early forefathers to procure their new homes in the colonies. Four Mile Tree, near the early Pace Plantation, is shown at sunset. Nearby is the tombstone of Alice Miles Jordan, wife of George Jordan and mother of Lydia Norwood. Her tombstone is the oldest existing tombstone in Virginia. Berkeley Plantation was begun 11 years after the first settlers arrived. It is one of the few fully restored plantations. It was connected with our family in early Virginia history. Berkeley was involved in the Indian Massacre of 1622. Today, thick foliage still screens the house from view. Many men gave their lives to create plantations in the new wilderness. One prominent family were the Parkers. Here we see one of the Parker family tombstones at St. Luke's Church in the Isle of Wight, a family member. St. Luke's Church at Smithfield, one of the oldest churches in the United States. Many of our families worshiped here. A few, for example, were the Wilsons, the Smiths, the Jordans, the Lyles, the Norwoods, the Parkers, the Powells, and many others. This old church at Lawns Creek Parish, Isle of Wight, has suffered from the ravages of time. William Norwood and his wife, Lydia Jordan, worshiped here with their family. Another of the ancient churches of Virginia is Old Blandford Church near Petersburg. This church boasts the tombstone of our ancestor Richard Yarborough, the oldest tombstone in the Petersburg area. The tombstone of Richard Yarborough has been broken. The name Scarborough was inadvertently put upon the stone. By checking sexton's records, the family researchers were able to determine that this was indeed the tombstone of our ancestor Richard Yarborough. As the colonies grew, the families spread from Virginia into North Carolina. Notable among them were the Parker family, who held over 1,000 acres on Parker's Creek in Nansemond, Virginia, near the North Carolina border. As the families moved about, they chose new home sites upon the creeks and rivers in North Carolina, much as they had done in Virginia. In 1729, Samuel Norwood owned land and islands in the Roanoke River. This shows one of his islands and the river. The countryside was not as heavily foliaged as Virginia. Instead, it was filled with verdant meadowland and luxuriant green grasses. This land at one time belonged to George Norwood's plantation. Soon plowed fields replaced the meadowland such as those we've seen. This is also old Norwood land. George and his family came to North Carolina in 1727. After the Parker families left Parker's Creek, they settled on Fishing Creek in North Carolina. Fishing Creek is one of the most beautiful creeks of the area. Many of the first settlers came here. Francis Parker arrived in 1745. This is the original site of the Parker plantation near Fishing Creek. The land has been described as being fertile and undulating. This beautiful spot was also a favorite camping ground for the Indians before they were driven out. Other families, such as the Yarboroughs, settled south of the Norwood and Parker families. There were seven Yarborough brothers who came from Virginia to settle in North Carolina. The Yarboroughs came about 1749. This is Yarborough property on the Tar River. Some of the earliest families in North Carolina were Wilsons. They were ship-owning families, and so were not obliged to wend their way down the coast. Consequently, they are found far south of those who came overland into Carolina. Wilson Meadows is owned by one of the numerous Wilson family. The Wilsons came in 1704 and 1710 into North Carolina. During the time that these early families were filtering down Virginia's coast, the Coon family came from Germany to Pennsylvania, going up the lovely Susquehanna. John Coon, our ancestor, was a young boy while British forces were leaving their boats and crossing the marshes of Cambridge that fateful morn when the Revolution began. Unbeknown to John Coon and his family, Paul Revere and William Dawes made their famous rides to the men at Lexington and Concord before sunrise. The tramp of 600 marching British troops was heard coming out of the morning fog toward the embattled militia at Concord, and a single shot began the war. The young boy, John Coon, lived near the banks of the tree-lined Delaware River near the tranquil city of Philadelphia, city of brotherly love. On the morning of this fateful day, John reluctantly roused himself from the snug warmth of his feather-quilted coverlet of German design and, rubbing the sleep from his eyes, prepared to meet a new day, one that would change his history and the history of the family. After washing his face and donning his clothing, he completed the early morning chores for his father, remembering how father always quoted this old German phrase, "The morning hours are golden," and John Coon followed his father's counsel. Meanwhile, Jacob Smith, future father-in-law of John Coon, stood amidst the stately pines and timbers of his farm in the Appalachian Mountains and kissed little Rachel and her brothers and sisters goodbye. Soon after, news of the war reached him. He volunteered to serve under the command of Colonel Pendleton. Not far from Philadelphia, they engaged the enemy near Valley Forge. It was a time to long remember. For Germantown and Brandywine Creek, the British learned that the colonists would not be defeated easily. Entrenched here at Valley Forge, Washington in his headquarters, with his troops in makeshift huts, prepared to stand against the British. The British had pushed them out of Montgomery in Bucks County, where the Coons and Smiths had family members and where Jacob Smith was born, but they could push them no further. The colonials stood their ground. During the war, the Coons, like the Smiths and others, their homesteads having become the battlegrounds of the war, started down the Shenandoah Valley with the hopes of new beginnings and the dawn of a new day. The wild scenery in this part of the country was unparalleled in beauty anywhere in the world. Amid such scenery, their hearts grew glad to be free in such a land. As they worked their way down the valley, they saw many settlers putting up homes, such as this beautiful log cabin. Groups of cabins soon sprang up in the Shenandoah Wilderness, such as the group at Dickerson's Mill, much like this settlement. The Kellys, Wileys, and Coons owned land near the Natural Bridge. Washington also loved this rock and carved his name upon it. Thomas Jefferson owned this bridge at one time. After the war, the paths of the Coons and Smiths crossed near Catawba Creek, Tinker Mountain, and the Great Lick in Botetourt, Virginia. Here in earlier days, Shawnee warriors trod the creek as they came up the valley on the warpath, going through Coalstone Gap. Here, below the small settlement of Fincastle, the families grew and prospered. To have gone much further south would have been to cross Cumberland Gap into Shawnee territory. On a day such as this, when the surrounding communities of New Amsterdam and Fincastle were pursuing their daily work, the families around Tinker Mountain, including Peter Coon, were preparing for a festive occasion. People from settlements as far away as Smithfield, one of the largest plantations, gathered together on August 15, 1799, to witness a marriage. They gathered at Stone Lay, the home of Preacher Mitchell, near Coalstone Gap, to see him perform the marriage of John Coon and Rachel Smith. After the ceremony, the family returned over Coon's Bridge to the old Coon home. Relatives even as far south as the Great Road to Cumberland Gap came to see the ceremony and participate in the festivities. Some of these were the Hensel and Hensley families who had their main settlement right at the Gap. Cumberland Gap was known for its wildlife and for its precipitous and mountainous beauty. This was the wilderness frontier. Soon after they were married, John Coon and Rachel Smith, like many others in North Carolina and Virginia, left their homes and went into the new lands of Ohio, Kentucky, and Tennessee. Some of the families that went into Tennessee were William Yarborough and Elijah Wilson. They were plantation owners from North Carolina. These families were the parents of the wives of Abraham Coon and settled in Palmyra, Tennessee. Upon the bend of this river, Elizabeth Yarborough, first wife of Abraham Coon, was born. Her father's plantation was upon this bend of the Cumberland River. Elizabeth Wilson is also listed as being born in Palmyra, according to family records. This old Yarborough home shows how these early homes on the Tennessee plantations were built. At this home, still standing, members of the family have many pieces of the old furniture. They still show the dining hall where their 40 slaves sat down to eat. John Coon's father-in-law, Jacob Smith, went to Indiana. He settled in country such as this, near Wabash River. John Coon and Rachel Smith settled on Heron Creek, Madison County, Ohio. Here, one lovely spring morning, their son, Abraham Coon, was born. Heron Creek was such a lovely area in its primitive beauty. Many Indians also lived near the Coon home. Abraham Coon always loved his birthplace near the glade. As he grew, Abraham worked on his father's farm. This farm was on the Virginia military land. It was given to veterans of the American Revolutionary War. The area where Abraham Coon spent his early youth was Madison Mills, Ohio. As he grew, Abraham worked with the animals on the farm. He particularly loved his father's blooded horses. This love of horses stayed with him all his life. During his eighth year, the family moved to Illinois. Here, at age 19, he met and married Elizabeth Yarborough. Many of the family lived here at Apple Creek in Greene County, Illinois, and five of his children were born here. Many of the family relatives were also buried here in Apple Creek Cemetery in Greene County. During the Black Hawk War of 1830-31, Apple Creek Fort protected the families from Indian raids. About 1842, Abraham and Elizabeth moved to Hancock County, Illinois, to be with the Mormons. Here, they also purchased a large farm, a land of beautiful, lovely, rolling, gentle hills. Abraham Coon's farm was located 3 miles south of La Harpe on the Crooked River. This is the roadway to Crooked River. The banks of the Crooked River were beautiful and tree-lined. There were lovely valleys and meadows in which he could graze his blooded Kentucky horses. The river itself was a small stream that meandered through the countryside, hence the name Crooked River. La Harpe had once been a fortification for the early explorer La Salle. Abraham Lincoln's uncle and family lived in La Harpe, along with Abraham Coon. Here, Abraham's daughter, Frances Ann Coon, and a son, Erastus, were born on his farm at Crooked River. Erastus died shortly after birth. He was buried nearby. Prior to this time, in 1839, Abraham Coon and Elizabeth Yarborough had joined the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. The main body of the saints lived at Nauvoo by the Mississippi River. We see the great Mississippi at Nauvoo in this scene. Abraham Coon attended meetings in this 70s hall in Nauvoo. He was ordained a 70 in the spring of 1845 by Joseph Young, a brother of Brigham Young. When the prophet was killed, his body was taken down this road from Carthage to Nauvoo. Our family history states that at one period, Abraham Coon was a bodyguard of the prophet. The day of Joseph's death, the people of La Harpe were close enough to hear the gunfire. They included Abraham Coon and his neighbors, Erastus and Eliza R. Snow, and their parents. In the upper room of the old Carthage jail, the now infamous assassination took place on June 27, 1844. During this time, Captain Abraham Coon of the Nauvoo Legion was on active alert to guard the saints at La Harpe from hostile mobs. During the time that the prophet was alive and after his death, they worked on the Nauvoo Temple. The families of farmers at La Harpe, where Abraham Coon lived, were responsible for feeding the temple workers and some of the church leaders. We know that at this time, the farm of Abraham Coon on Crooked River provided for many of the saints. The saints at La Harpe were responsible for successfully encouraging the saints at Nauvoo to complete the temple, in spite of Joseph's death. This is the point of Exodus. Many families crossed the river during the month of February 1846, leaving behind their possessions, farms, and beloved city of Joseph. On January 31, 1846, Abraham Coon sold the several hundred acres of his farm to a Mr. Rice for one-third his purchase price, and then with his family joined the Exodus. Looking back across the river, they saw their beautiful city and the spire of their lovely temple. The weather was bitter cold, the snow deep. Many suffered, many died, while camped here, awaiting spring thaws. This is Sugar Creek, where the pioneers camped. Ironically, Abraham Coon's brother, Jacob, lived here with his family. He was a minister of the Christian Church. He later visited Abraham's family in Utah. Another brother, David, had been one of the first settlers at Sugar Creek, arriving from Commerce in 1834. The saints made their first camp here at Garden Grove. They built homes, dug wells, put up fences, and put in crops. The settlement was to provide resources for the saints to push on to the Rocky Mountains that year. Abraham Coon was appointed to be one of 100 men to go to the mountains. The second permanent camp was at Mount Pisgah. At Pisgah, they did the same things they had done at Garden Grove. While here, some of the young men went down into Missouri to find work. On the Grand River in Missouri, Abraham's brother David and uncles Jacob and Henry were establishing settlements. At the bend of the Missouri, near Council Point, Abraham Coon, who was among the vanguard companies of the Saints, was selected to run the Indian Mill at Mosquito Creek, 3 miles northeast of Council Bluffs. Here at the Indian Mill, Abraham worked for S.E. Wicks, Indian agent for the Potawatomi Indians. Here on Mosquito Creek, as a young boy, John Coon, Abraham's oldest son, caught a catfish that was almost too big. In fact, it almost pulled him into the creek. Francis Ann recorded the incident. This is the type of country that the Indian Mill was situated upon. It was a beautiful, grassy area. Until the 1860s, this area was periodically raided by the Ottawa and Sioux Indians. Not until after the Civil War did their raids cease. Across river at winter quarters, Brigham Young had Frederick Kessler build another mill. This was a Mormon mill. The mill operated by Abraham Coon was a government mill, built 10 years before the Mormons arrived for the Potawatomi Indians. This area was known as Mill Branch. Bishop Abraham Coon held his meetings at the mill, and the area soon became known as Mill Branch. Later, it became known as Garner Township. James and Mary Walker, brother-in-law and sister of Abraham Coon, moved here in 1850 to take up Abraham's farm when he moved west. After they left Council Bluffs in June 1850, Isaac Coon was born to Elizabeth Wilson and Abraham Coon as they camped on the Elkhorn River in Nebraska. In the distance, they could see the broad, shallow, and tree-lined Platte River. This is the campgrounds on the Elkhorn where Isaac was born, June 18, 1850. Camp journals record, "Today we fetched a little coon. An infant son was born to Abraham Coon." As they traveled across Nebraska, they saw many beautiful scenes, such as this. Crossing the Platte River was always a dangerous job for the pioneers. Many times, the wagons overloaded would sink in sand. Death was also a frequent visitor and stalked the wagon trains. Cholera often contracted from drinking impure water. Many of the pioneer camps along the way were also filled with this dreaded disease. Abraham Coon saw thousands of buffalo on the plains. The great herds did not begin disappearing until 20 years after the pioneers. They were killed by the hundreds when the railroad crossed the prairies. This is Scott's Bluff, Nebraska. It is a landmark along the trail and was noted by the Coon family as they made their trek west. These bluffs are near Chimney Rock. When the bluffs appeared, the pioneer scouts knew that Chimney Rock was nearby. Soon they would be leaving the plains for the high plateaus of Wyoming. Chimney Rock, one of the most famous landmarks of pioneer times, has only recently eroded away. In those days, it stood much taller. It seemed to stand as a sentinel and a signpost to the weary travelers. By this time, the pioneers had been on the trail almost a month. As they progressed into the mountains, the landscape became rough and hilly, and small lakes and depressions such as this one began appearing. These were also buffalo wallows and areas where Indians could hide themselves while following the wagon trains. Near Fort Laramie, Wyoming, they crossed the North Platte River. It was here that they heard the cannon fire from Fort Laramie, a reminder that this day was the 4th of July in 1850. This was one of their ferry crossings. The crossings were seldom easy, often fraught with danger. Oftentimes, wagons overturned and livestock were swept away by fast waters. Independence Rock was one of the fascinating parts of the scenery along the Pioneer Trail that was viewed by Abraham Coon and his family. Two divisions of the wagon train headed for the Black Hills from this point. They were warned of Indian unrest and kept a guard out at all times. They passed the Wind River Mountains and South Pass. They would soon reach their destination. Captain Coon's company, part of the 2nd Division, were in better shape than the 1st Division and were able to make better time. When they reached Fort Bridger, they knew they were on the last lap of their journey. Near here, the wagon train was stopped, and the wagons were searched for Army deserters. They entered the Great Salt Lake Valley and viewed the Great Salt Lake and the Ochre Mountains, little knowing that their history would soon be entwined with those of that mountain chain. It was here that Coonville began about 1852. With Rudger Coon as our guide, we begin at Uncle Dave's Lane to tell the sights and sounds of Coonville. Here, our ancestors, as barefooted children, savored the warmth of the sun on their heads and the feel of soft sand between their toes. We step into Dave Jr.'s school wagon for the trip around Coonville, with Uncle Rud as our guide. Rudd points out the Hardman trees, which will soon turn red and gold with fall colors. Under the trees lies the foundation of the old home site, filled with tea vines and a profusion of wild yellow roses. The old well still yields some of the best drinking water in the Salt Lake Valley. Toward the north, Rudd points out the side of the Ochre School in Isaac W.'s Lane. At the end of the lane are the large trees of Uncle Ike and Aunt Kate. Abraham Coon built here in 1855 for Elizabeth Wilson, his third wife. Next, it's like we see Uncle Ike's home and his family. We dismount from the wagon at John A. Coon's and look across John A.'s lawn back to Uncle Dave's. John A.'s old barn was built in 1882 from hand-hewn logs brought from Coon's Canyon. Returning to the wagon, Rudd directs us to turn our eyes to the east and a lovely group of trees before we move on. As we view the Salt Lake Valley, we visualize through these trees the old home of Oliver and Mary Schaefer. Here they homesteaded after they were married. Riding southward from John A's home, we turn right and traverse Oak Brush Flats. We see the Ochre Mountains here, framed by the dwarf oak brush, a rare variety in Utah. And it was here that Indians camped long ago. Now Rudd allows us to again dismount and view the farms from a distance. He tells us of the Indian encampments here at Oak Brush Flats. And we see, as the Indians did, the little settlement of Coonville stretching jewel-like before us. Some of us decide to walk. We approach the oldest home site in Coonville. The willows were planted by Aunt Tabitha when they built the home in 1855. They are among the oldest trees on the west side of the Salt Lake Valley, planted by pioneers. Rudd invites those who wish to follow him to climb to Eagle Rock and enjoy the beauty of the Salt Lake Valley from this unusual vantage point. We see Abraham Coon's old ranch site at the willow trees just below us. Here we enjoy a panoramic view of the beloved valley of our ancestors. Turning our faces southwest, Rudd points out Coon's Peak. We climb into the wagon and ride across Oak Brush Flats to the junction. Rudd points out the old Eck home site below the present site of Bacchus. As we continue on, Coon's Peak looms larger in the distance. We soon enter the canyon itself. The next stop that we make is in Coon's Canyon. Dismounting from the back of the wagon, we can see the Salt Lake Valley slowly disappearing from view. Turning back, we see Coon's Peak in the distance, beckoning us on. The horses pull the wagon slowly past Wildcat Rock, Gunderson's Hollow, and Sugarloaf. Higher up is Willow Spring and Porter's Hollow. And at last, we find ourselves at the forks of the canyon. Stopping, we dismount to look up the dugway in left-hand fork. While we admire the view, Rudd unharnesses the horses and stops for a rest. This is where the old cabin stood. A noise comes from a large stand of trees. We move quickly into the forest shade. Before our startled eyes, we see Grandfather Abraham Coon's old mill. We run toward it in eagerness, but when we reach it, it is gone. Have we seen a mirage? The reverence with the past is broken. Somehow, though it is gone, we feel a part of it, knowing that the spirit of those times remains in our hearts. Looking toward the mountains, we find we have somehow become a part of the past, a part of them. The centuries have not totally obliterated their lives. Coon's Peak still stands as a noble ensign, thrusting itself into the blue sky. Coon's Peak, glittering white in the winter morning sun, and tawny brown in the summer, stands in proud and resolute majesty above the Ochre Range. For more than a century, it has borne the name of Abraham Coon. But more than this, it has become the eternal symbol of a family name whose heritage and meaning lies deep in antiquity.